Hello guys, this is Indian Medico and in this video, we are going to see a review of anesthesia. First, let us see the definition of general anesthesia. General anesthesia is defined as drug-induced loss of consciousness during which patients are not arousable even by painful stimulation. Now, let us see the triad of general anesthesia. Unconsciousness or amnesia, analgesia and muscle relaxation. These three are known as triad of general anesthesia. During general anesthesia, the ability to independently maintain ventilatory function is impaired. So, we have to provide airway assistance for the patient by way of intubation or laryngeal mask airway. Now, let us see about the stages of anesthesia. Anesthetic drug effects can be divided into four stages of increasing CNS depression. Stage 1 is analgesia stage. Stage 2 is excitement stage and stage 3 is surgical anesthesia stage. Stage 4 is medullary depression stage. These are the four stages of anesthesia. Now let us see about ASA physical status classification used for surgical patients. ASA is American Society of Anesthesiologists. ASA 1 is a normal healthy patient. In this case, the risk of mortality is 0.1%. ASA 2 is a patient with mild systemic disease. In this case, the mortality is 0.2%. ASA 3 is a patient with severe systemic disease. In this case, the mortality is 1.8%. ASA 4 is a patient with severe systemic disease that is a constant threat to life. In this case, the mortality is 7.8%. ASA 5 is a moribund patient who is not expected to survive without the operation. In this case, the mortality is 9.4%. ASA 6 is a declared brain dead patient whose organs are being removed for donor purposes. Now let us see about rapid sequence intubation. A mnemonic to remember the steps of rapid sequence intubation is 8 P's. First, we have to prepare equipment. Then we have to pre-treat the patient with drugs. Fentanyl can be given in the dose of 0 to 3 microgram per kilogram. Then we have to position the patient in sniffing position. Then we have to pre-oxygenate with 100% oxygen. Then we have to give pressure. That is, we have to use Selix maneuver to give cricoid pressure. We give manual pressure on cricoid cartilage to occlude the esophagus and decrease the chance of aspiration of gastric contents during intubation. The next step is paralysis using drugs. Then we have to do placement of the endotracheal tube. Then we have to confirm the position of the tube. Direct visualization, that is seeing the tube pass between the vocal cords, is preferred over end-tidal CO2 for confirming the position of endotracheal tube. Now let us see about anesthesia induction. Intravenous anesthetics are the most common way of inducing patients. Now let us see about various intravenous anesthetic agents. If you notice, for all the intravenous anesthetic agents, the onset of action is very quick and the duration of action is also very less. Thiopental is given in the dose of 3 to 5 mg per kilogram. It is used in narcoanalysis. Contraindications for the use of thiopental are hypotension and asthma. Contraindications for the use of methoxetal are seizures, hypotension and asthma. Etomidate is used in the dose of 0.3 mg per kilogram. It is used in patients with cardiovascular system compromise. It is contraindicated in children less than 10 years of age, in pregnant and lactating women. Fentanyl is an opioid. The onset of action is 2 to 4 minutes and the duration of action is 45 minutes. The dose of fentanyl is 2 to 5 microgram per kilogram. Fentanyl provides analgesia only, that is, there is no amnesia with fentanyl. The contraindications for the use of fentanyl are hypotension and respiratory depression. Midazolam is a benzodiazepine. It is contraindicated in narrow angle glaucoma. We have to decrease the dose of midazolam in elderly and patients receiving concurrent erythromycin or drugs that inhibit P450 system. Ketamine is given at the dose of 1 to 1.5 mg per kilogram. It is used in patients with shock and bronchial asthma. Ketamine causes dissociative anesthesia. The contraindications for the use of ketamine are head trauma and elevated intracranial pressure. Propofol is given in the dose of 2 to 2.5 mg per kilogram. It is used for induction in daycare surgery, neurosurgery, thoracic surgery, and endoscopy. Propofol is a lipid emulsion, so we have to use it with caution in patients with disorders of lipid metabolism. We have to follow strict aseptic technique while giving propofol because it is an emulsion and it is a great growth medium for organisms. So if we don't follow proper aseptic technique, it can lead to sepsis. Now let us see about neuromuscular blockade. Neuromuscular blockers act at postsynaptic receptors, which are located in neuromuscular junction, and they block acetylcholine transmission. There are two types of neuromuscular blockers. They are depolarizing muscle relaxants and non-depolarizing muscle relaxants. Example for depolarizing muscle relaxant is succinylcholine. The mechanism of action of succinylcholine is that it acts as acetylcholine receptor agonist and causes paralysis. Contraindications for the use of succinylcholine are hyperkalemia, burns, rhabdomyolysis, narrow angle glaucoma, Guillain-Barré syndrome, malignant hypothermia, and other neuropathies. In these cases, it can lead to dangerous hyperkalemia. There is no specific antidote for succinylcholine. The only antidote is time, that is, we have to wait for endogenous blood pseudocholinesterase to metabolize succinylcholine. Patients deficient in this enzyme may be paralyzed for hours with succinylcholine. Now let us see about non-depolarizing muscle relaxants. Examples include pancuronium, vicuronium, atracurium, and rocuronium. The mechanism of action of non-depolarizing muscle relaxants is that they act as competitive antagonists of acetylcholine at neuromuscular junction. Atracurium and cisatracurium undergo degradation by organ-independent Hoffman elimination, so they can be used in patients with hepatic and renal dysfunction. Anticholinesterases prevent breakdown of acetylcholine. This allows acetylcholine to compete more effectively with non-depolarizing muscle relaxants. So anticholinesterases can be used to reverse neuromuscular blockade of non-depolarizing agents, and they are given at the end of surgery. That is, an antidote for non-depolarizing muscle relaxant is neostigmine. A specific antidote for rocuronium and vicuronium is sagamedax, which is a selective relaxant binding agent. Now let us see about anesthesia maintenance. The various options for maintenance of anesthesia are inhalational agents like nitrous oxide, isoflurane, sevoflurane, and desflurane. Intravenous agents used for maintenance include opiates, ketamine, and propofol. The minimum alveolar concentration, or MAC, is the anesthetic concentration that produces immobility in 50% of patients exposed to a noxious stimulus. Higher the MAC, higher the potency of the drug and lower the dose of the drug needed. Blood gas partition coefficient is the solubility of inhaled anesthetics in blood. It is inversely related to induction rate, that is, lower the blood gas partition coefficient, faster the induction and quicker the recovery. Brain blood partition coefficient is the ratio of anesthetic concentrations between blood and brain tissue when partial pressures are equal. Higher the brain blood partition coefficient, higher the solubility of that substance in brain tissue. Now let us see about various inhalational anesthetic agents. Nitrous oxide has a very high MAC, so it is an incomplete anesthetic. It has a rapid onset and recovery. It can diffuse into closed spaces or lumens, causing expansion of bowel or worsening of pneumothorax. So it is avoided in middle ear occlusions, pneumothorax, and small bowel obstruction. Among the remaining agents, the newer agent is desflurane and the older agent is halothane. If you notice, from the older to newer agents, the MAC increases, the brain dead partition coefficient decreases, and the blood gas partition coefficient decreases. Desflurane has a low volatility. It is a poor induction agent because it has a rapid recovery. It can be used for maintenance, but it is an irritant. Sevoflurane has a rapid onset and recovery. It is unstable in soda lime. It can be used for induction, especially in children. Isoflurane has medium rate of onset and recovery. It is used for maintenance. Halothane also has medium rate of onset and recovery. It can lead to halothane hepatitis, which is immune mediated hepatotoxicity. It is used for induction and maintenance in developing nations. Now let us see about anesthesia emergence. It is the return of patient to an awake state. The patient should have full muscle strength and protective airway reflexes before extubation. During emergence, patient is at risk for aspiration and for laryngospasm, that is involuntary spasm of laryngeal musculature resulting in inability to ventilate the patient. Now let us see about the differences between pediatric airway and adult airway. Intubation is more challenging in pediatric cases. This is because they have a large tongue in comparison to their oral cavity. The larynx is higher up in children. It is at the level of C3, whereas in adults it is at the level of C4 to C5. The larynx is funnel shaped in children. The narrowest part is at the glottic opening. It is beyond what is visualized with a laryngoscope in children. In children, the vocal cords are at a slant and they are more anterior. It is important to remember that infants and children are not just small adults. Their physiology is dramatically different, affecting their anesthetic management during surgery. Also, in infants, the emergency surgical airway of choice is a tracheostomy and not a cricothyroidotomy. Now let us see the differences between pediatric airway and adult airway with the help of this diagram. In case of children, as discussed earlier, the tongue is larger in proportion to mouth, the pharynx is smaller, the epiglottis is larger and floppier, the larynx is more anterior and superior, the narrowest part is at the cricothyroid, and this can't be visualized with the help of laryngoscope. The trachea is narrow and less rigid. Now let us see about neuraxial block. Some important points to remember regarding anatomy for neuraxial block are: subarachnoid space lies between arachnoid and pia mater. It contains cerebrospinal fluid. The spinal cord ends at L1 to L2. The ilia crests are at the level of L4. Now let us see about spinal anesthesia. The indications for spinal anesthesia are surgeries of lower extremities, lower abdomen, genitourinary and anal region. We have to insert the needle at L3, L4 or L4, L5, that is at the level of ilia crest. At this level, cauda equina is present and spinal cord has already ended. Obstetric patients are at increased risk for aspiration when general anesthesia is undertaken. So, in these cases, we prefer spinal anesthesia. It is important to remember that spinal anesthesia is generally used for surgeries lasting no more than 3 hours. This is because the anesthetic is injected only once in case of spinal anesthesia. Now let us see about epidural anesthesia. The indications are the same as spinal anesthesia, that is, it is used for surgeries of lower extremities, lower abdomen, genitourinary and anal region. It differs from spinal anesthesia in that the needle is placed in the epidural space, that is outside the CSF. Commonly, an indwelling catheter is left in place for epidural anesthesia. This provides continuous anesthesia because we can periodically bolus the catheter for prolonged surgeries. epidural anesthesia takes longer to obtain effect and requires higher dosages than spinal anesthesia. It is technically more difficult and requires more time to place than spinal anesthesia. This picture shows the various layers that need to be pierced for giving epidural and spinal anesthesia. This needle is epidural anesthesia. This needle is spinal anesthesia. If you notice, for giving epidural anesthesia, we have to pierce the skin, subcutaneous tissue, supraspinous ligament, interspinous ligament, ligamentum flavum. If you pierce all these, you will reach the epidural space. For giving spinal anesthesia, in addition, you have to pierce the dura mater and arachnoid mater. Now let us see about the complications of spinal anesthesia and epidural anesthesia. Hypotension can occur. This is due to sympathetic nervous system blockade. It is more common with spinal anesthesia than epidural anesthesia. Nausea can occur. This is due to unopposed parasympathetic activity. Again, it is more common with spinal anesthesia than epidural anesthesia. Post-spinal headache can occur. This is due to CSF leak. It can occur with spinal anesthesia or due to inadvertent dural puncture during epidural placement. Urinary retention and backache are common side effects of both spinal anesthesia and epidural anesthesia. Permanent neurologic injury can occur, but it is very rare with both spinal anesthesia and epidural anesthesia. Epidural abscess or hematoma can occur rarely with epidural anesthesia. Another side effect is orthostatic hypotension. Now let us see about the local anesthetics. Local anesthesia is used for local infiltration of operative site. It can be used during spinal or epidural anesthesia and peripheral nerve blocks. How do you classify local anesthetics? We can classify local anesthetics into esters and amides. Esters have a single I in their name. Amides have two I's in their name. Examples for esters include cocaine, procaine, and tetracaine. Examples for amides include prilocaine, lidocaine, and bupivacaine. Now let us see about the mechanism of action of local anesthetics. They act through blockade of sodium channels. Myelinated fibers are more susceptible to blockade. Sensory fibers are more readily blocked than motor fibers. For motor blockade, we require 2 times the dose when compared to sensory blockade. Non-ionized form of local anesthetics is needed to cross nerve sheet. However, ionized form is the active form. In case of local tissue acidosis, that is in case of infection, there is increased ionized drug form. This limits anesthetic activity. So, local infiltration into an area of infection may not produce adequate analgesia. This is because non-ionized form is required to cross nerve sheet. Lidocaine is acidic. This can cause burning. So, we have to add sodium bicarbonate to lidocaine to decrease burning sensation. We can add epinephrine to local anesthetic to prolong duration of action by vasoconstriction. But we have to avoid epinephrine in areas with lack of collateral blood flow like scrotum, penis, fingers, toes, ears, and nose. Now let us see about toxicity of local anesthetics. Initially, there will be CNS effects like tinnitus, perioral or tongue numbness, metallic taste, blurred vision, muscle twitches, drowsiness, restlessness, vertigo, and seizures. Later, there can be cardiovascular side effects like hypotension, PR prolongation, QRS widening, and dysrhythmias. In case of large overdose, there will be seizures, coma, and respiratory arrest. If you inject bupivacaine intravenously, it can lead to cardiac dysrhythmia, leading to fatal refractory dysrhythmias. Now let us see about malignant hypothermia. It is an autosomal dominant inherited hypermetabolic syndrome occurring after exposure to an anesthetic agent. The causative agents of malignant hypothermia are volatile anesthetics and succinylcholine. It is very rare, but it can be life-threatening. It is due to impaired reuptake of calcium by sarcoplasmic reticulum in muscles. Now let us see about the signs and symptoms of malignant hypothermia. Tachycardia, ventricular dysrhythmias, hypothermia, hypercarbia, acidosis, hypoxemia, and muscle rigidity are the various clinical features of malignant hypothermia. Rising end-tidal carbon dioxide is the earliest sign of malignant hypothermia. Now let us see about the treatment of malignant hypothermia. We have to discontinue anesthetics. We can give body cooling. Benzodiazepines work fastest to control hypermetabolic state. However, dantrolene sodium is the definitive treatment. It is a calcium channel blocker. The onset of action takes about 30 minutes. Now let us see a classical case of malignant hypothermia. A 48-year-old woman undergoes a hysterectomy and develops an acute increase in end-tidal carbon dioxide in the middle of the operation and then develops a very high fever, cardiac arrhythmia, acidosis, and hyperkalemia. This is a classical case of malignant hypothermia and it should be treated with dantrolene sodium. Now let us summarize whatever we have learnt with the help of this tabular column. The various components of anesthesia are unconsciousness, that is amnesia and anxiolysis, analgesia, and muscle relaxation or paralysis. How do you monitor amnesia? We have to monitor with electroencephalogram and clinical signs. We have to monitor analgesia with heart rate, blood pressure, and respiratory rate. We can monitor muscle relaxation with a nerve stimulator. Now let us see about the drugs used for amnesia. IV drugs include benzodiazepines like midazolam, lorazepam, and diazepam. Antidote for benzodiazepines is flumazenil. Other intravenous drugs causing amnesia include barbiturates, etomidate, and ketamine. Potent gases which cause amnesia include sevoflurane, desflurane, isoflurane, enflurane, and halothane. Weak gases which can cause unconsciousness include nitrous oxide. Now let us see about drugs used for analgesia. Intravenous drugs used for analgesia include opioids like fentanyl, morphine, and hydromorphone. Antidote for opioids is naloxone. Non-opioid analgesics include ketamine, paracetamol, dexmedetomidine, acetaminophen, and IV ketorolac. If you notice, only ketamine acts as both analgesic and amnesic drug among IV drugs. Now gases which can cause analgesia are the same: sevoflurane, desflurane, isoflurane, enflurane, and halothane. Nitrous oxide is a weak gas that can cause analgesia. Now let us see about local anesthetics. They can be divided into amides and esters. As discussed earlier, amides have 2i. Examples include lidocaine, bupivacaine, ropivacaine, prilocaine, and mepivacaine. Examples for esters include cocaine, procaine, chloroprocaine, tetracaine, and benzocaine. These drugs have only one I in their name. If you notice, local anesthetics can cause analgesia and muscle relaxation, but they don't have properties to cause unconsciousness, that is, they don't cause amnesia and anxiolysis. So we have to use local anesthetics along with an IV sedative for amnesia or anxiolysis. Local anesthetics are also used for peripheral nerve blocks like brachial plexus block and femoral block. They are also used for central nerve blocks like spinal anesthesia and epidural anesthesia. Now let us see about muscle relaxation and the drugs used for it. IV drugs used for muscle relaxation can be divided into depolarizing relaxants and non-depolarizing relaxants. Succinylcholine is a depolarizing muscle relaxant. Examples for non-depolarizing muscle relaxants include pancuronium, vecuronium, rocuronium and atracurium. Inhalational agents like sevoflurane, desflurane, isoflurane, enflurane and halothane can also cause muscle relaxation. If you have any suggestions, please let me know in the comment section. For more such videos, please check out my playlists. If you like my videos, kindly subscribe. Your subscription will encourage me to make more videos.